Welcome to the Lady Wisdom Talk Show. Yes, I am the hostess, Lady Wisdom, the beautiful and the amazing Lady Wisdom. Today we have a exciting story, a special guest. He goes by the name of Rodney Roberts. He has a story that's going to blow you off your foot and help some of you guys out there who may be experiencing the same situation, may have a family member who is in the same situation that he was in. And can you please introduce yourself?
Hello, my name is Rodney Roberts. I'm here on the Lady Wisdom Show. I feel honored to be here.
Yes. And I was reading your story. You are an exoneree.
Yeah, I was exonerated March 12, 2014 by DNA evidence. I spent 17 years wrongfully convicted, innocent in Rahway State Prison. It was the 17 years that was a struggle in my life, and I managed through prayer and preservation to come out and be able to help the community today.
Yes. Let me ask you, when you was convicted for?
I was convicted for a kidnap and a sexual assault. What really happened was when I was arrested for an unrelated incident, a fight over a motorcycle, mm-hmm. and my public defender misinformed me and coerced me to plead guilty to a crime I didn't commit. He lied to me because his caseloads were so overwhelming. He didn't see me as a human being. He just seen me as a statistic. And he used every tactic that he knew to convince me that if I did not plead guilty to this crime, that I would spend the rest of my life incarcerated. And I just did not, I could not see me in prison for the rest of my life for a crime I did not do. But he convinced me that I would be home in 2 years. Mm-hmm. He told me that the record would reflect that no one was hurt, so thinking I was saving my life, I pled guilty to a crime I didn't commit.
Right, so he was pretty much working against you.
Yes, I mean, him and the prosecutor and the judge, they all formed a trifecta to persuade me and coerce me into entering the plea agreement. And still to this day, in pursuing the prosecutor office, I still was unable to get any accountability from the state on the matter.
So you said he pretty much talked you into pleading guilty for something. This was, he said he will get you off in the next 2 years, you'll be free to go.
He told me, he convinced me that the victim was out in the stand, had positively identified me, and that they was ready to go to trial, and that if I did not plead guilty, that I would spend the rest of my life in prison. And all this was a lie. Years later, through an investigation from an attorney, when they went to go visit the victim, she never even identified anyone. They showed her my photo, and she told them that that's not the guy. I never even picked him out. And she also came to court and testified that I was not the person in open court, which wasn't enough. At that point, once she said it wasn't me, the judge just told her credibility wasn't no good at that point anymore to clear me.
Okay.
And so.
So did at that point when the victim said, no, you're not that guy, did they even go with the DNA testing? Tell me about the DNA testing, because I do know they do test you, take
right.
strands. Yeah.
Well, they did that. They took the DNA, they took all the strands, mm-hmm. they called the kit, the rape kit. And,
right.
But what happened was the Exoneree County Prosecutor Office claimed they lost it. The kit for 9 years. For 9 years,
it got lost.
They
in
said
the
we can't find it, and every time we would request it, oh, they sent investigators to look for it. We lost it; it's not there. So I wasn't able to test my DNA and prove my innocence. So now, 10 years later, so that's after 17 years of being in prison, in 2013, after the higher court got frustrated with the lower court constantly denying my due process. They assigned me new counsel and a new judge, and mm-hmm. lo and behold, the material mysteriously appeared. And it was able to sent to the state lab, and I was exonerated, cleared 100% as being innocent of the crime.
Wow.
Yeah.
And how old are you now?
I am 47 right now.
And you served 17 years. So you've been incarcerated since you at the age of 30.
Yes.
Pretty much so.
Yes.
Oh, wow. Let me ask you, how did your family, were you married and have any children?
Not at the time.
No. Okay, not at the time.
Yeah, so I had a son. And that's who really I was wanted to get home to.
Okay.
It was him who I wanted, I wanted to get home to him. That was part of the reason I entered the plea agreement. And after serving 17 years, coming home, I experienced a serious culture shock. I mean, even technology, like when I left, you know, we had a flip phone. You know, I left mm-hmm. and the phone just on, you know, my phone only had a GED. I mean,
right.
I come home, my phone's smarter than me. It got college education. So I'm listening at the phone and trying to learn how to use even this new technology, catching up with the cultural differences, you know.
I'm sorry, let me ask you, you explained it to me how you adapt from the change, because you was like 30 years old when you was incarcerated,
right.
you know, 17 years you served,
right.
And the adapt, like you said, technology
right.
was on the rise from right. then, and how are you adapting now?
Well, I've had a good support system, and that has been my blessing, but, one thing, I came home, I didn't come home bitter and angry. So that made me more people wanted to help me because I didn't have a chip on my shoulder. So I was able to get a lot of good counsel from a lot of good people to help me move through some periods that I may not understood the changes. 17 years, that's a teenage life. So there's a
right.
whole generation that I never even, that's unaware of me.
Right.
So
you mentioned that you didn't have any bitterness towards you. I mean, I'm sure it probably grew, you know, as far as it grew away, you know what I mean? The bitterness. But my question was, was there any bitterness toward, you know, the guy who falsely accused you?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, still to this day, I mean, I'm pursuing a lawsuit. I'm in federal court now in litigation for compensation.
Okay.
And the bitterness is only, you know, maybe for the other individuals who are incarcerated, who are in prison, and who public defenders, I know, are going to mislead them. I mean, there's a big problem in with the system regarding public defenders and their overwhelmed caseload. And then up against a prosecutor office who have complete immunity and no accountability, you can't even sue a prosecutor. So, you know, so what I've been doing since I've been home, I've been fighting for prosecutorial misconduct reform. Mm-hmm. I've been to Albany to the legislative body speaking to try to help with another organization,
mm-hmm.
Exoneree's, to get a bill passed for a oversight committee for prosecutors.
Okay.
And so that has been, I'm also now in law school. Pursuing
That's
my
great.
Law degree,
mm-hmm.
and my goal is to, utilize my talent, because 65, maybe 75% of all litigation done to exonerate myself, I did pro se. So I had to learn law, I had to learn how to write, type, research,
wow.
and help myself.
So that was how your time was spent during those years?
Yeah, I worked in the law library for maybe 14 years, and to the point where there's a number of individuals out now who I see who I've gotten out, either a sentence reduced or their conviction overturned, but I couldn't get myself out. So
right.
I spent my time fighting against the system, saying that I'm going to get as many guys out as I can to fight. That was my way of striking back.
Right, right, right. And when you were in prison, what was prison like?
Prison was a horrible experience. I mean, it's very... the hostility,
mm-hmm.
The inhumane aspect of being stripped of your liberties,
right.
Being told, everything. I mean, you got to ask someone to give you a roll of toilet paper.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're locked in this room.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a horrible experience. I mean, I was in a dark place at one time because early on in my incarceration, I was so angry with myself because I felt like I betrayed myself
mm-hmm.
for pleading guilty. So I was a little problematic in the system.
Did you go through like a mental or nervous breakdown in the course of those years that you were in?
No, I've never had a nervous breakdown. I never went to, had any mental health issues or any, mm-hmm. but I did go through some depression.
Right.
I did have some anxiety and a lot of stress. And, but over the years I had to find a way to compartmentalize these things if I was going to survive. And so.
And what actually kept you going after all of that? Because you did mention in the beginning, it was like you did have some issues, like a little bit depression. You was depressed. What kept you going? What made you want to fight, you know, after spending like 7 years done went by? You know what I mean?
Right.
And it's like, it's nothing. What made you want to fight? What kept you upbeat?
Well, one thing that I've always been given since I was a child is a belief in God. You know, my mother instilled that in me. I've gone through church since I was maybe 4 or 5. So I always knew that I always had a strong belief in God. And, you know, although at some point I didn't realize how much I would have to lean on my belief. Mm-hmm. But as the years went by and I realized that it was too much for me, so I just turned it over to God, and because it was overwhelming me as a man. And when I did that, I learned how to get out of my own way. Things didn't bother me so much because I could put it in prayer and then move out to do what I had to do.
Right.
When they say lock in, sometimes I didn't want to lock in. Like once or twice, I refused to lock in because I said I'm not supposed to be here. So, you know, I had to learn how to find strength in the situation, you know. And plus, I had to learn how to be mentally free. You know, because you could be physically in prison, but I had to learn how to be mentally free. And I did a lot of reading. I would travel vicariously through literature and, you know, and keep myself from being stuck in a prison mindset.
Okay. And did your family, you know, did you have any, was there any moral support? Like your family, did they write you?
Oh, yeah.
Did they come visit you?
Yeah, they came visit me. I got 6 sisters, 3 brothers, you know. My sister's always, my mom's, who's 84, Shirley Roberts, but you can't tell if she's not 50 or 40 right now. She's ball of energy. Right. And they always came, you know. My sisters were, you know, like, would challenge me. I was like, when you come to see me? They'd be like, well, when you gonna come see me? You know, so it was that kind of back and forth. But they love me, and still to this day, they hold me down.
That's good. Yeah. That's good. What we're going to do, we're going to go into commercial break, and we'll be right back with Mr. Rodney Roberts. Back to the Lady Wisdom Talk Show. And as you see, we do have a guest host. And just introduce yourself.
Yeah, my name is General Messiah Ntilikimati Makwa. Most people call me General Messiah. I'm a motivated speaker, martial art instructor, teacher, artist, and a variety of other things that I'm affiliated with different organizations for a good cause for the community and a reentry program.
Okay, great. And we're back to Mr. Rodney Roberts. We were on, he's an exoneree. And the last question we left off, we were talking about prison. Right. And I wanted to ask you, in prison, did you work there?
Yes, I worked as a paralegal.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I worked, that was really the only job I had. Mm-hmm. I refused to do anything else but work in the law library. I started out as a clerk, and then as my skill developed through older prisoners who were there, like guys like Charlie Jenkins and Elijah Ritchie and Omar Shabazz. So they took me in and showed me some of the skills. And as I got sharper, I became the head paralegal in law library.
Okay, and what, I'm curious, and I know everybody out there, they're curious too. What do you get paid? What did you get paid on a monthly?
Well, you know, you get paid like $1.20 a day.
Oh, okay.
I mean, you get paid, $1.20, have upscale, like $3. If you make $3 a day, you like,
big
you're
time.
In the suburb.
You, and like, you work you got, 8 hours? Is it an 8-hour job?
Well, it's not based by the hours. You get it by the day. No matter what, this is your pay, $3 a day. So if you could work 10 hours, all you're getting is that.
Okay, yeah,
hours,
that's what I meant. Yeah. And how many hours? Okay, so did they give you a set amount of hours you had to work each day? That's what I'm trying to ask you.
Well, yes.
Okay.
You had to be according to this, whatever schedule they gave you, yes, you had to meet that schedule. But in the law library, I had flexibility. You know, I was able to stay longer or leave earlier. And, you know, which I spent, like, all my time there. Most guys go out and play basketball, play cards in the yard.
Right.
I was in the law library reading books and doing legal work and, you know, fighting my way out of the system.
Okay. And how does it feel to be released after 17 years when you step foot out, you know, into this world, this new world? You know, you see that we have technology now.
Yeah,
everything changed.
Yeah.
And you see people like, okay, you know. How does it feel?
Well, it feels
your freedom.
Great. I mean, it's a feeling that never goes away.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I always tell people I'm still living in Viva Loca. I'm celebrating right now. Everything is a celebration for me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, everything I do is like I look at it as a happy moment because it's a feeling that you know it feels like my freedom now as an adult. I know what it is. I know what it is not to have it, and I know what it is to be mentally free and physically free. And spiritually free at the same time, you know, and have that ability to laugh in times when I shouldn't, and be able to smile in times of adversity or hardship when I shouldn't. I just look at it and be like, you know what? You know, I'm gonna get through this like I got through that, or get through everything else.
Mm-hmm.
And so, freedom for me means that, you know, it means not just free itself, but it means free to take on responsibilities, you know, because that's what I love doing. I'm, you know, being goal-orientated, taking on new responsibilities. I just got started at the OAR program, which is the Offender Aid and Restoration Program in Newark. And I'm on staff there with Ms. Jenny Brown, wife of Rain Brown, the famous lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I just look for the opportunities, and it just feels good to be able to help others.
Absolutely. And that's what it's about, helping others,
yeah.
You know. And your son, when you came home, what was his reaction?
Oh, he is ecstatic still to this day, you know.
Mm-hmm.
When I left, he was, you know, he was a big guy, you know, but now he's like 6'4", like 290, you know, he's been to college. He's a great guy, you know, he's never been arrested. He's not, you know, getting high, he don't drink.
That's
you
great.
Know, I mean, I love the man he's become. In spite of my absence, at least when I was in his life, I left enough foundation that he had something strong to hold on to.
Right.
And he always thanks me for at least giving him the building blocks at a young age that he could have grown and withstand the peer pressure and still in his path.
Right, and I know you guys spend a lot of time together.
Yeah, that's my dude right there.
Yeah.
I really love him. And I try to call him every day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I tell him I love him. You know, where we at? I say it all loud. You know, he'd be all mushy. Come on, Pop. You know, but you know, I want him to know that how much what he means to me, because he is a large part of my inspiration.
Right.
And so him and my mom's. You know, my mom's. It's my girl. I adore my mom. So, you know,
Mama's boy, huh?
I make no disagreement with it.
Oh,
I
hey.
No problem
yeah,
with
absolutely.
It.
That just means that you're loved. That's all that means. You're
no
loved. And I'm going to give it over to Mr. Messiah.
Okay. It's an honor. It's an honor to see that you're out here, and that's wonderful.
Absolutely.
You're an example of many other individuals that have been railroaded to prison for a number of crimes, some of the most hideous crimes, and eventually they found out they was innocent. They took DNA, they found out somebody came forth and confessed it. One gentleman did 45 years for something he didn't do, murder, and somebody confessed that. It was in Ebony many, many years ago. But the question I want to ask you, what type of books did you study while you was incarcerated?
Well, I was part of a different program, so I had a list. It was called the 105 list of books that you had to read, mandatory books, like The Miseducation of the Negro, The Destruction of Black Civilization, Enemies Clash of the Races, Message to the Black Man, The ISIS Paper by Francis Cresson Wilson.
Right.
You know, so I had a litany of authors that I had to study. Marcus Garvey, Noble Drew Ali. So, you know, my studying regimen was very, very intense because of the brothers who oversaw me. Like, one of my mentors was Sudi Adeshikor,
right.
who was Asana Shakur's co-defendant, Joanne Chesima. So he took a liking to me, and he felt that there was something in me that he wanted to impart his knowledge. So he gave me a series of books. In fact, he's the one who gave me my first correspondent course. And so from that, I started taking correspondent course. I went to college. I managed to get a bachelor's degree while there, correspondent for University of South Carolina in logistics. So I really have engrossed myself in education. And because I believe in education, and I believe that one of the biggest problems in the penal system is the high illiteracy rate. You know, most of the young guys there, they can't even read, and how they're pleading guilty to a plea agreement and to a crime without understanding the words on the paper is amazing to me. So as a result of that, I promised myself that I was going to come home and make those issues known, and that you can, even after imprisonment, come home and still piece your life together. No one said it's easy. I'm not sitting here trying to sell that you hope it's easy, but you know, you have to make a choice if you're gonna live that criminal addictive lifestyle. You want to continue to think like think you could get over, or you'd be slick, or think you know you're gonna still dip and dab. You have to pick a side. You know, you're gonna have the streets, you live the streets, but look, they got sidewalks too. You know what I'm saying?
You can't be lukewarm with it.
You know what I'm saying? I chose the sidewalk. So you know, because I'm not, you know, saying I don't have, you know, that desire, plus at my age, to spend my life in the streets. I really don't. You know, I want to be in a position where, hopefully, God willing, by 2018, I want to be a member of the bar, and I want to be able to go back and represent individuals that who possibly will be railroaded, or you know, help their families at least. So that's my struggle.
Okay, that's good. The idea I like was how you were studying these different books that gave you Afrocentric disposition and principles about your system.
Absolutely.
To know right from wrong and all this sort of stuff.
Well, now, no, before I learned right from wrong from my mother and father.
Okay, that's good.
That's where it started.
That's good. But I'm talking about from a political perspective.
Right.
You know, the radical type of ideology that you developed over a period of time, like Pan-Africanism.
Black nationalism and whatnot.
So that's a value system.
Exactly. Right? Absolutely.
It teaches you a different type of right and wrong from the family.
Right.
I understand that.
Right.
I'm not disputing that at all. But the idea of dealing with society, the judicial system and whatnot.
So you as became, a black man.
So you became involved in the legal system that enabled you to understand the system, how it functioned, how you got trapped off in, and how to get out of that. Now, what was interesting question was raised before about the fact you made a statement yourself that you was able to help a lot of people get out, but you couldn't help yourself get out.
Right.
And that's true with a lot of paralegals, jailhouse lawyers, as they may call them, right? They always had that problem getting out.
Right.
My suggestion is that they should help each other, represent each other, and they got a better chance because they're more objective.
Well, we did that because one of the things you can't do is write for yourself.
Right.
And we would do that. I mean, I spent a lot of time, because I can't write my own sometimes. It took me years to learn how to write in a third party. And I had to have others because I'm so looking at it subjectively, I couldn't learn how to.
That's what I'm talking about.
You know, I look at it objectively, but they call it a paralegal curse, you know, that you can help everyone else, but you can't help yourself. But I broke that curse because I started saying, well, that's enough of that. You know what I'm saying? Everybody going home, I started. So I devoted, I decided to isolate myself a little bit more and focus more on myself.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this other question there. Before you came to prison, what level of education you have?
I was high school graduate.
Oh, high school graduate.
Yeah.
Okay, you was on your way to college then.
I had choice, college, military, you know, I had no juvenile record, I had no record at the time.
Everything was clean.
So, you know, I had a choice of where I was gonna go with it. So.
Yeah, the reason I asked that question because it kind of reminded me of when Malcolm X first came to prison, he did about 6 years or so, he didn't have a formal education, but you did have some formal education, which is good. And it took him a whole, you know, it took him some time to really get himself together. Just he was reading a lot of books like you was doing. And he got Afrocentrically involved, even though they didn't use that terminology at that particular time, but that's what it amounted to in essence. And there was some brother that introduced there. Was there any brother that introduced you to knowledge in there? Any one particular brother? I know you mentioned Sudiata.
Well, one of my good friends, Omar Shabazz. At the time, he was in the Nation of Islam. You know, and I was a little stubborn. I didn't want to listen to a lot of guys, you know, because I had my own ideas of how I saw life. And so I was a hard nut to crack, they used to always say. Don't leave that guy alone, he don't want to hear that. But he was the one guy that, like, little brother, come on, I don't want to hear that. You gonna, you know, listen to me, you gonna hear, just stop what you do. So he stayed on me for such a long time that he wore down my resistance. Mm-hmm. So he became like a big brother to me.
Right.
And still to this day, you know what I'm saying?
He's
still,
like your mentor in a sense.
You know what I'm saying? He calls me daily, check on me, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And we still have a very good rapport. We able to work through our problems because we men, and we
right.
don't agree. I don't agree right. with everything he said, and I let him know that. You know what I'm saying? Because right. I'm not just an agreeable guy. I'm
yes,
not a yes
yeah,
man.
Yes
right.
man.
So,
right. That's good.
But we able to work through it because of our relationship. Mm-hmm. So, Omar Shabazz, I would have to say, is that
okay,
guy.
Okay, that was your instrument.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. George Jackson, Elgin Cleaver, Malcolm X, all of them had somebody to influence them, which
right.
is a good thing. It's a good right. foundation. And I'm very happy to hear that you're out here, that you have proven your innocence to the crimes, and that's going to be helpful to a lot of the people that you're going to help.
Right.
And I understand that you're working with some organization right now. Do you know the name of it? Can
well,
you give me the name of it?
Right I work, now? I'm on a staff at OR.
At OR?
The
okay.
Offenders Aid Restoration Program.
Right. Okay.
And, but I've been working with other exonerees for the last 2 years. I don't even know 18 months. This, but for the last 18 months, I've been working with other exonerees, like the Jeffrey Desford Foundation,
okay.
and also a foundation, It Could Happen to You. These are other exonerees who were wrongfully convicted and who successfully were compensated, like Jeffrey Desford. He was compensated. He took some of his winnings and he started his own foundation.
Right.
And he helped me when I came home also to understand what it is as a exoneree to have to develop that passion to
right.
fight back, you know, and against prosecutors and their misconduct. Mm-hmm. And so and him and other the additional organization of exonerees, we all like the Innocence Project. Mm-hmm. I'm a very big, you know, fan with, you know, I have a very strong support system of Innocence
okay,
Project.
That's
uh-huh.
good.
With, Barry Sheck, who I always who calls me a lot as well.
Right, that's
and,
good.
And I have a mentor also now, two actually, Leslie Reisinger, who is the dean of law at Seton Hall, who is my homegirl, and who's a very beautiful woman. She has a very good heart. And
right.
Dr. Matthew Johnson, who is associate dean of psychology at John Jay College. I speak very frequently at both colleges to their exoneration classes, and they helped me expand my knowledge out now.
That's
and
good.
Broaden my scope, not just to look at things locally, because my goal is to eventually go to Trenton and challenge legislation in Trenton.
Well, that's
and,
good.
So,
well, I'm gonna give you a point on that. There's Alumni Association, they're based on a reentry program. They go into various facilities that is predicated on the halfway back programs, and they speak at these different places. Also, they got two laws that have been passed. No box sign, no
yeah.
box, right?
Right.
That was
ban
eliminated.
The box.
Right, ban the box. I was instrumental in that myself.
Right.
There's another one we worked on was drug-related crimes,
right?
Where these individuals don't have opportunity to get social benefits,
right? I just
find
saw
housing,
you
employment,
that, right?
Right,
right.
Right.
Yeah,
so
actually,
let me finish.
Yeah.
We won that already.
Right.
Now, only thing is, it had to be signed by the governor.
Right.
That's the only holdup.
Right.
Right. So we got quite a few other bills we're working on now
right.
to get
right.
into effect. You interested in participating in a program like that?
Well,
the Alumni Association
is my people from POP, People Organization of Progress.
Yeah, I'm familiar with them.
Right.
I remember
and so
that myself.
Their president, Lawrence Ham. He is like someone who I've traveled to Trenton, to, you know what I'm saying, and he always supports me with that. So I'm always willing to challenge legislation.
Right.
One of my pet peeves is the legislation 2C35 that governs drug-related offenses
right.
and how individuals who are convicted for drug-related offenses, when they're released, they are totally cut off from society. They're not able to get any benefits, not even welfare, not even
that's
social,
true.
Not housing. Mm-hmm. And you're talking about reentry, and but yet you have this big, large segment. And like they are like maybe 80% of the convictions are drug related.
Right.
So you have a large portion
population,
of ex-offenders who can't progress
that's
because
true.
You have this archaic legislation that bars them from moving forward.
Right.
So, and so how you, you got
with credit, let's right. say you want to,
yeah,
the bank account.
They can't get anything. And because of this, and you have President Obama who came to Newark and touted
exposed,
Newark as a reentry mecca. So, but yet you have this big population who can't move, you know, they can't live with certain family members, so they can't make parole because they can't live there because they have drug offenses and the lease doesn't allow it, or they can't get Section 8, or if they have Section 8,
right,
their family can't allow them to come in. Or,
right.
And so, I mean, they cannot, only thing they're left with is the return back to that lifestyle, because how are they going to eat? You got to eat.
Right.
You got to have somewhere to live.
Need,
I mean, and you're talking about guys, and that's why so many of the youth who have been convicted for drug-related offenses, you see out there the way they are, you know, and engaged with them because they've been cut off.
Right.
You know? And they no one wants to say that, you know.
Right.
And that's the hope they need. They need to be able to adjust back into the community without the stigma,
right,
you know what I'm saying, without the bars and with these laws that tell them they can't even, I mean.
Keep talking.
Yeah, they can't even get public assistance. I mean, they need money for food.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can't get a job because you got a drug conviction.
No.
And they saying, no, we can't hire you. And you can't go live here because you got this. So you can't live here. So you got to stay with your boy in his basement or live on someone's couch or living on the streets. Or, you know what I'm saying, because you've been completely cut off from society.
Right.
So those laws, you know, I'm all for going to train and challenge
those. That's good.
Laws. I am, actually, that is my next, you know, because I've been to New York and I'm popular in New York legislator, talking to their legislator. I met with Governor Cuomo's head counsel and some, but that's New York. I'm from Newark, New Jersey.
Right.
And this is where I should be focusing my energy to help, you know, and, you know, I have a problem with Governor Christopher, because, you know, I have a problem with his leadership and his, like most people, and who his way of creating laws that undermine the inner city, you know.
Yes.
He completely undermines, and people don't see it, the long-term effects of these laws he's passing. So, yes, right. I mean, that's your answer to your question.
Well, you're on point.
Yeah.
You know Yasin, right?
Yes, I'm about to do an interview with Yasin Williams.
Yeah.
He's another brother who mentored me.
Right. He's challenging the 2C law. What we're trying to do is get all these individuals to come together who did a lot of time in prison to establish certain types of bills. We're trying to try to turn a life sentence to 30 years under the 2C law, because you got a lot of 2A.
2A, yeah.
Right.
I heard about a meeting that they had recently, Emo Island, and I was...
Right, but we're going to have a master meeting. We got one with Gail Muhammad. I don't know if you're familiar with her. Okay,
yeah.
She's instrumental, and I was telling you about before, dealing with Women Never Give Up. But she deals with a lot of reentry programs and stuff of that sort. So there's a lot of intellectual people out of prison who educate themselves. They're on a college level, and they want to do something positive in society. They have no intention of getting involved in crimes or instituting any type of drug programs or all that. They're getting away from that. There's one individual named Arnett Thomas.
Yeah, I know Saul.
Yeah, that's Taou, right?
Yeah.
He had hooked up a book called Crime Anonymous.
Yeah, and the Freeman Project.
Called CAP.
From back in the day.
Right, he did that a long time ago.
Yeah.
And he's putting that back in effect now. When we get off the stage, I'm going to change some notes with you and get you in contact with him and see what could be materialized from that perspective, along with some other people as well.
Right.
But I want to thank you for this interview. I'm sure you got some, probably have some more
questions. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to go into commercial break, and we'll be right back.
Okay. All right. Now, what we're going to talk about this.
Yeah.
It's Messiah. Oh, you want to read? Once again, my name is Messiah in Chilakimati, and most people call me General Messiah. My last name, of course, is Mukmuk. But anyway, I want to thank you for spending the time with us here, sharing your life experiences, what you went through, the various trials and tribulations, how you better yourself since you was incarcerated in order to survive the dehumanizing conditions that exist there, and your expertise in the paralegal field that helped you get yourself out, as well as quite a few other people, and your continued work to help people who have been unjustly treated and subject to wrongful convictions. And that kind of remind me of another brother who did a lot of time in Trenton State Prison and Rahway as well. And they called him the boxer, the master boxer.
Hurricane Carter,
right?
Oh, yeah.
He did the same thing. He hooked up a program in Canada, and unfortunately he passed away several years ago. So I'm not gonna hold you up too long, because I know you want to say something. She got something to ask, you know, say as well as a closing, right? Again, we appreciate you being here, and we appreciate the knowledge you share. And I'm gonna pass it on to this beautiful sister here.
I'm so Lady beautiful. Wisdom. I'm so amazing. Okay, I'm Lady Wisdom. No, but I really appreciate you coming through on the Lady Wisdom Talk Show, sharing your story, enlightening us with the information. I want to get a little bit personal with you. What is it that, what are some of your hobbies, you know, do you like to do?
Movies. Okay. I like movies. You know, I'm an avid coffee drinker. You know, I don't even really have any one specific thing. I like doing whatever is in the moment. You know, I like laughing. I like hanging out. I like spending time with good people.
Okay.
You know, I just, you know, I don't have one specific hobby. I want to get back into chess. That's something I really love chess.
Okay.
I'm really good at chess. And but I spend so much time, my hobby is helping people. I think that if I had to say a hobby, that would be it, you know, because I have a passion for, especially with coerced plea agreements. That's really my pet peeve, because so many people are in prison, not just wrongfully convicted, but one of my issues that I'm fighting for right now that I think is like, when individuals are arrested, they may be charged with like 10 counts. And indicted for maybe 10 counts. So the prosecutor come to him and say, hey, if you cop out to two of these counts, we'll dismiss eight. When they should have only been charged with two anyway. You know, it's only two counts anyway, but they use the other eight counts to pressure this individual to plead guilty to these crimes, because they have this multiple counts on the indictment. I want to bring that to light more also. So I guess, you know, my hobby is helping people and, you know, joking with my mother, who has a very good sense of humor.
Oh, okay. So you a jokester, comedian.
I like to have fun.
Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah, I do.
And what type of music you like to listen to?
A club.
What's in your car?
That club, hip-hop. I like, you know.
You like it all?
I like it all, but club particularly. You know, I get on dance floor and tear it up, so that's...
Okay,
dance,
so you got to come to one of my events then. That's coming up in February.
Let me know. I'm there. I get out there and I really enjoy dancing, because that's my freedom too. Mm-hmm. Dancing is the way I like to, you know,
to release.
Yeah, you know, it's spiritual to me to get out and dance for. But it's some good club. You know,
yes. So. And what are some of your favorite foods? I told you we're gonna get a little bit personal.
I basic, like spaghetti.
Okay.
I like spaghetti, you know, I'm stereotypical, but I like chicken, fried chicken.
Okay.
exactly.
Yeah.
And, pasta meal, shrimp. I love shrimp, you know. Any shrimp Alfredo, the sauce and everything.
Okay.
I you know.
He's making me hungry.
Yeah, I just, you know, after eating what I had to eat there, you know, I enjoy good food. I like to have a good meal.
Let me ask, what did you have to eat there?
Foods there, I mean, you have the lowest grade foods, you know, because they have to feed a large population.
Right.
So they order the cheapest quality of foods.
Oh, okay.
Foods that's in a bag that you squeeze out a bag, and this is your meal, and you're looking at it and you waiting for it to stop moving before you can eat it. So it's great. So Yeah. It was a horrible, you know, the most you could survive on might is the vegetables or something. And mm-hmm. you know,
they have a lot of starch, like rice.
Starchy foods and bread. You got to take a loaf of bread back to your cell mm-hmm. and possibly get you some peanut butter and jelly because mm-hmm. or some soup and tuna. Right. Or to survive in there, because if not, you're going to starve.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Was that awful. What would you leave? We're leaving. We're about to, you know, everything is about to be shut down here. What would you leave the listeners with, the viewers? What would you say to those who are in the same situation that you are in? You know, what would you say to them? How can they get the help?
Well, first, I would tell them to learn to forgive themselves mm-hmm. and to have faith in God. Mm-hmm. And in that faith, become your own lawyer, you know, become your own aid, you know. Prayer without work is just words. You
right.
have to get up and have faith that there's hope, you know, because there was plenty of times I felt hopeless, mm-hmm. but I had to fight that off. And, you know, so I guess you have to learn how to protect yourself from yourself and fight off your emotions, but never give up that hope. You know, because that's all you have. And even out there and out here, you know, you still never give up hope that you could do better. Because, mm-hmm. you know, it's never over, you know. And if you believe in God and you put God first, you could, that's a strength that you can, no one can take from you.
Absolutely.
You know, so.
Yeah. So, thank you guys for tuning in. The Lady Wisdom Talk Show. Yes, I am your hostess, Lady Wisdom. Until next time, I'll see you. Talk show. I'm here live with Rodney Roberts at his workplace. He's going to let us know a little bit about what he does at OR. And introduce yourself, young lady.
Thank you for the compliment. Jenny Brown is my name. I've been the executive director of OR since 2006. I was a founder of OR with five or six other people in 1984. At that time, I was a... OR is a nonprofit organization that was started in 1984, and it is has mission has been to service men and women and adolescents who had the unfortunate experience of going to jail and to prison. We were asked by a gentleman in 1984 who had started OARs in the state of Virginia and across the country, and we managed to survive all these years. It is not a particular work, which was to prepare them for a life that would be free of crime. That's a hard tasks for some more than others, but we always believe that everyone has a second chance. In the case of Robert, Mr. Roberts, is the core problem of many, many of our clients that leads to criminality. I think that also lack of income, lack of jobs, lack of adequate education also affect the young people's futures, and without strong, without adequate education and family life and other things that people have when they're socialized and growing up in families, can result in negative outcomes. We have a children's program called PATCH, Parents and Their Children, and I started that as the second in the United States in 1984 when I was on another, and it's one of the, I would call one of the secrets of OAR that I have been very proud to be a part of, and continue to keep it alive so that the children who are the, what I call the, they are the true victims of crime. And that in itself is something I could lecture on for about an hour. Let me take you on a tour of see where we do all this. We've been in this building since 2006, but 2010. And we started in Irvington when we regrouped, but OAR had been several places. Essex County College was its first site when the volunteers first founded it, and then it went to High Street, and then we went to Irvington, and now we're here at 303 Washington Street in Newark.
Okay. Let me ask you, what does OAR stands for?
Oh, Offender Aid and Restoration, and then of Essex County, Inc.
Okay.
We are a nonprofit, and that is that is our formal and official name.
Okay. So what we're about to do, we're about to go on tour in the building, and go ahead, I'm following you guys.
All right. We have served our grants that we have been getting for some years. Generally involve 150 or 200 people, and we have had in the last two grants excellent. In 2014, the end of 14, we had a grant of 150 people, of men and women. 50 of them had to be. We had to choose or to identify 50 that were had violent offenses. The other 100 nonviolent. And what was most interesting is that we only lost 8 people after a whole year of involving them in reentry services. And that is a miracle, because the reentry, the recidivism rate for people going back to jail is something like 70%, the last I read. So Rodney came here to get help. One of our wonderful September, Jerome Young, and he had been apparently received Rodney in a manner that made him remember that there was one place he could go to and seek help. The picture, if you want to turn around, there's a picture of him on that board. We celebrated him last fall when he died suddenly.
Very popular brother, very, you know, heartfelt in the community. His loss was very heartfelt.
Jerome Young.
Yes, Jerome Young, a.k.a. Wally in the community.
Yeah, he helped Wally so many Barr. Of us. Wally Barr was his name.
Yeah, he helped so many of us. Every time he saw him, he made me pull over my car, even get off the bus, and come talk to him.
I am Joyce Flowers. I'm the clinical director of OAR Counseling Center. This is my office. Come on in.
I'm in the office of Mr. Rodney Roberts. This is where the magic happens.
I make the magic
happen. Yes, he do what it do.
Yeah, you know, I keep it at.
Yes.
Keep going. Progress. Mm-hmm. Whatever Ms. Brown asked me to do, research for her grant, to get it done, I get it done. And, you know, I'm just happy to be a part of the OAR program, and that she would let me sit and learn, and, you know, give me opportunity to provide whatever services I can to other individuals who come in for resources, information, reentry, job opportunities, resumes, legal aid. I mean, I try to provide a full service based on my skill set to help the community. I have a passion for helping people. I got it naturally from my mom, so You know, I enjoy seeing people do better.
You heard him. He get it from his mama. Let me ask you, so anyone from the anyone can walk up in the office to get help with resumes or anything like
that? Yeah, we have a complete computer room in the back.
Oh, okay.
We can sit and you can go online and fill out job applications online if you need to.
Okay.
So most individuals, male and female, they may not have access to computers to fill out, and most applications now are online. So that's a service that we definitely offer to the general public. So, and it was just very important.
Yeah,
and
that's great to know, because I've never known that.
Yeah, you can walk right in. And what I do is I try to help them develop resumes so that, you know, they, when they leave, I make sure they leave with a resume, some decent resume, cover letter. And, you know, we just try, and job readiness as far as helping with a presentation, which is very important. And, you know, we just want to make sure, help them with punctuality and taking the necessary steps to secure a job. You know, and that ambition that goes with it, too, because it starts with that self-ambition. So we work hard here always to make sure that people, but the main thing those with substance abuse counseling, you have a thorough substance abuse counseling, intense outpatient program that is very effective for those who are interested. You come into a warm environment where people will generally try to help you, and that's one of the things that attracted me. To help, no one's turned away, and so under that banner, that made me feel like that. Even when I'm doing in a wrongful conviction community, fighting for prosecutorial misconduct reform, that this is home for me. I'm a long resident of Newark, born and raised, Rough Rider, you know, graduate from Queen of Andrews. So I, it's nowhere for me really to be except for here with this, what I could do.
How long have you been here with OR? How long have you been working with OR?
I just started recently. I'm only here new now, maybe close to a month. But OR has been helping me for 2 years.
Nice.
They've been helping me since the day I came home. I came here, that's 2 years now. So the OR program itself,
it's beneficial.
I love it. And that's why I'm here today and trying to do whatever I can to help.
Great.
So, okay, we're going to finish this tour. Sure. I'm going to see. And, this is the other office. He's doing a zip line.
There's five computers there, but this computer lab, since you have to have a resume in order to get a job nowadays, so we help people learn how to use a computer and how to create a resume and be creative with that.
How are we going to work?
So you guys heard it. If anyone need help with their resume, this is the place to come, or.
This is another conference. When we have a lot of clients here, we can do group rooms. We have three group rooms, and there are times when employers come to interview our clients. This will make you cry. It looks so wonderful. They come in here with white shirts and prepare to have an interview and to give a urine of. They got to have clean urines, and it's always made me think that I was in the right kind of work. I think we have another group room, but I don't know that you need to shoot another one. Anyway, we thank you for coming. We never have enough public relations, but OR has been around 32 years, and I hope it'll be around another 32. And I will do my best and with the help of Rodney and other people who care a lot about OR, to ensure that it stays viable, because there are too many people coming out, there are too many going in to prisons, but I hope our society will do something about putting people, nonviolent people, in jail and charging, paying taxpayers, pay so much to have very nonsense kind of people, nonsense charges. And it used to be $40,000 a year to keep somebody in the county, not the county jail, but the state prison. And that's just shameful. And that's sinful, and that's criminal, if you ask me. That to take hardworking people like myself and you and others to keep people, and it's a punishment that borders on words that I can't even use for you. But it is, we have to have another way to help the young men and women who fall down, and we have to get our schools in better shape, and we have to build our family homes and to have a sense of where kids can recreate and or can have proper recreation, after school programs, all of those good things that I think have fallen by the wayside. And if we could do more of that, we would certainly have people would have a chance to have a working career and to build their families and to protect them, and so that everybody lives, as they say in the storybooks, happily ever after. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thank you. I think this program is just wonderful. It's beautiful, what you have set out for the community and helping others. This is really great.
My mission?
Your mission.
My mission is to just believe. Just believe.